Father, thank you for this beautiful afternoon. In the name of Jesus Christ, rebuild and bind every foul, wicked, evil spirit. We can go from here right now in Jesus' name, that your word may have free course in the midst of us. And other people say, amen. Now, today I'm going to share with you from the Word of God how you can experience greater measure and measure of the blood purchased inheritance that Christ has for you. Right? When he died for us on the cross. Many times we have dreams. We have great visions. All right, we want to start this business. We have got a particular school. Or perhaps overcome a particular bad habit or addiction. And month after month later, perhaps year after years, we kind of give up the dream altogether because we don't seem to see anything happening. And I suppose sometimes we just give up and say, hey, life is as good as it can get. I'll just settle down where I am right now. But I tell you the truth, your best days are still ahead of you. And other people say, no devil, no circumstance, no people can keep you from your destiny. What we need to do is that you have to shake off the self-pity, shake off the resentment, shake off the discouragement, because the Bible tells us in Galatians chapter 6 that God says, do not be weary in well-doing, for in due time you come into your season, and other people say. In the Bible, there was a story of the prophet Elijah during the time of King Ahab. There was a drought, not for 1 month, 3 months, but for 3.5 years. Perhaps some of you are going through a season of dryness in your life. Things are not moving as fast as you believe God for. Your dreams are not being fulfilled. You felt so dry, there's no joy, there's no happiness. Hey, how many of us know there will come a season of increase in your life, and other people say. Suddenly the prophet came along and said, hey, I hear the sound of the abundant rain. Take a look at the passage in 1 Kings chapter 18.
Then Elijah said to Ahab, go up, eat and drink, for I hear the sound of the abundant rain.
Now, when the prophet said, I hear the sound of the abundant rain, I can imagine some of the people, especially the false prophets of Baal, were laughing their way. Huh? And there was not even a drop of rain. But eventually, there was a tremendous downpour. The fact is that the downpour came not immediately after. Remember, there was a battle between the prophets of Baal and prophet Elijah. Elijah gave them a challenge, go up to the Mount Carmel, and asking the people, choose to worship the true God, not the false God of Baal. And the prophets of Baal came along, and they put in the sacrifice, and they cried, and they screamed, they cut their hands. Nothing happened. Fire didn't come down and consume the sacrifice. But Elijah, the prophet, poured water on the animal, the bull, more water, drenched it, and yet he said a simple prayer. He didn't even scream. How many of us know you don't need to scream in your prayer? All right, God is not deaf, okay? And he just cried out, Lord, please bring fire. Fire came down, consumed the entire sacrifice. But there was no immediate downpour until Elijah did this. Verse 42.
So Ahab went up to eat and drink. And Elijah went up to the top of Carmel. Then he bowed down on the ground and put his face between his knees.
The Bible tells us that Elijah the prophet bowed down between his knees. And I believe it is a picture of total worship. I believe it's also a picture of thanksgiving, a picture of praise. And there was no breakthrough. And sometimes we thought, Master, I thought you said it. When Christ died for us on the cross and he brings us this amazing blessing summarized in the five blessings of the cross, how come I'm not experiencing it? It could well be. What is in the Bible the picture of rain? Rain is a picture of blessing. Rain is a picture of increase. Rain is a picture of abundance, of joy. Now, how do we get rain? Well, the sun heats up the vapor, and it rises up to the sky, and there is enough water vapor, and there is enough mass, and it's too much for the sky to hold, and it will rain, and sometimes it pours. None of it, the vapor. What is the vapor that could cause God's blessing? Let me tell you this. It's what Elijah the prophet did. He bowed between his legs, and he began to worship, and he began to praise. And I believe praise, worship, thanksgiving is the key to really precipitate the downpour of God's blessing in our life. Now, put it this way, your prayer, your worship is not a work, right? That make God bless you. No, it's not a work. Prayer, worship, and thanksgiving is simply to lay hold of the privilege that God has already given us, to lay hold of the privilege that we have in Christ, of the intimacy that we have in Christ. See, Christ died for us on the cross and made possible for us for all this astounding blessing. Hey, praise, worship, and thanksgiving is the key to receive all this blessing. And today we'll look at one of the feasts of the Holy Land. Remember, I got a dream. God says, speak on the holy feast of the Holy Land. And we come to the last, perhaps the most important feast, the Feast of the Trumpets. And from the Feast of the Trumpet, we learn astounding revelation and truth on how to really precipitate the astounding blessing that God has for us. Now, the Feast of the Tabernacle, another name, is the Feast of the Ingathering. Say, Ingathering. It is a feast that celebrates the greatest harvest of the year. How many like to receive the greatest harvest of the year and the greatest harvest of your life? This feast will present us the truth on how to experience that greatest harvest, the Feast of the Ingathering. It is also called the Feast of the Lord. Now, we have been rushing through as we teach on the various feasts, but this one we want to really focus. We're going to spend a couple of weeks, all right, to really explore, all right, the various astounding truth. Why is it also called the Feast of the Lord? But today we want to talk about the Feast of the Ingathering. Why it is the Feast of Ingathering, and it's also the Feast of Tabernacles. You know, this is plural. The word is different from the word that is used for the temple of Moses, the temple or the tabernacle. This is actually the word sukkor here in the Hebrew, simply means tents. And the feast, as I said, is to celebrate the final harvest in anticipation of even greater harvest. How many of you know that your better days are ahead of you? And other people say, and you're going to launch out and believe that God could bring us greater and greater harvest. How to precipitate that? Well, there is enough of vapor rising up, and there is enough mess up in the sky, and you and me could experience the astounding downpour. And other people say, amen. First and foremost, how they celebrate the feast? Well, they celebrate the feast by giving thanks to God for what they have received, even in simple tents. Take a look at Leviticus 23, verse 14.
On the first day, you are to take choice fruit from the trees and palm fronds, leafy branches, and poplars, and rejoice before the Lord your God for 7 days. Celebrate this as a festival to the Lord for 7 days each year. This is to be a lasting ordinance for the generations to come. Celebrate it in the seventh month.
Now look up, you see this picture of the booths, of the tents that they're supposed to be staying in, and up on the, they put in all kind of branches and leaves, all right? And they're supposed to live in this tent for 7 days. And the reason why they live in this tent for 7 days is to remind them of their journey in the wilderness. Remember, they were there 40 years before they entered the promised land. And they got to celebrate, they give thanks to God that even in the wilderness, imperfect situation, they experienced the astounding provision of God. Remember, none of them were feeble, the Bible tells us. The Bible tells us that their clothing and their shoes were not torn. And God provided them with all the riches, the gold and the silver they have taken up from the land of bondage. And in the midst of the wilderness, how many are going through a season of dryness? Hey, even in your dryness, even in your imperfect situation, God is well able to bless you. That's what they are called upon to give thanks for, to give thanks to God even in the midst of their imperfect situation. Pastor, I don't like this house that I'm staying in, this one-room flat. Oh, I don't like this particular job. I don't like this particular place. I don't like the environment of this place that I'm living in. I don't have this privilege. I don't have that privilege. Hey, circumstances don't have to be perfect before you are blessed. God is well able to bless you even in the worst of time. And other people say, but Pastor, I pray, I really pray. And I prayed very hard for God's favor. I did all the numbers, but I didn't get the job. Hey, let me tell you, if you doors are not open for you, it is because God has other doors for you. And other people say, oh, Pastor, that joker, what out of this relationship that we have been having for the last 2 years? Hey, I'm reminded, no, we can give thanks that even in the midst of that brokenness, He can give us beauty for ashes. Give thanks even in imperfect situation. Give thanks for what we do have, instead of what we don't have. Oh, Pastor, I don't have talent. I don't have connection. I don't have this privilege. I don't have that privilege. Hey, you may not have natural connection. The Bible tells us you have supernatural connection. So give thanks for what you have. And because we focus on what you don't have, how many of us know we're going to lose our joy, we're going to lose our peace. If you're not careful, you may enter into depression. How often have you done a house renovation? Chances are we go into the house that has been renovated. The focus is on, the contractor didn't do this, the contractor did that. Hey, the fact is that perhaps the contractor has done 1,001 things. Of course, we need to give suggestion. We need to ask things that have not been done to be done. But you're so focused, and we are so focused on what is not done, and we get upset. It's okay to know, identify this area not done, that area not done, and tell it to the contractor nicely, graciously. Another thing, to be all upset, woke up, angry. Hey, don't let what is being not done steal the joy that you have in Christ. And other people say, amen. Oh, Pastor, the traffic conditions getting bad to worse. Look at the potholes. And okay, when you identify a pothole, try what you can, do whatever you can to improve the situation, but don't allow the potholes to steal your joy. Give thanks that at least in our country, there are roads. All right, there are many countries in the world today, there are no roads. All right, I've been to some of the mission situation. Man, they only have dirt roads, okay? Oh, Pastor, my parking lot is 3 blocks away from my office. Give thanks to God, because at least you have the licks. That when you ask and command the lick obey. There are many people, not only they wish to have your parking, they also wish to have your licks. So give thanks for what you do have. Because now that they're going to steal us of our joy, the danger of us getting into depression, when you don't focus on the right thing, instead of focus on the wrong thing, you focus on what you don't have, instead of focus on what you do have, it's going to cause you to live a defeated life. You know, studies have shown, all right, psychologists done a study of 10,000 mental people, patients in hospitals. Every one of them got one common characteristic. They are perpetual fault finders. They always look at the negative, they get upset, angry, all right, what is not done, sort of what is done. And as a result, they lost their joy. And they're not careful, they go into depression. Like what I said yesterday to the young people, when you're looking for a boyfriend and a girlfriend, what important criteria is not the 5 C's. But so what are the 5 C's? Condominium, credit card, and cars. Cash. Yeah. One vital criteria, I always tell our kids, is he a perpetual fault finder? He's always grumbling about this, grumbling about that. The best thing you can do, stay away from him. Because how many of us know God can never use a negative person? Remember the 10 people that came back and reported a negative report? All right, the land are great, but, the fact is that they are giants. Now, always look at a negative. You know what? 10 people cost 2 million people the loss, lose the opportunity to enter into the promised land. How many of us know negative people can cause us to lose our inheritance? That's the reason why Psalm 1 says, stay away from mockers. Don't even sit with them. Because it's going to, there, the negativity, it's going to cause and rob us of our blessing. That's the reason why it's important for us to give thanks. This Feast of Tabernacle is to remind us that we're going to give thanks even in an imperfect situation and give thanks even if we don't have, instead focus on what we do have. All right? Because Abraham is very important, because as you give thanks, you release faith. And giving the thanks, even as you release faith, Abraham must know God responds to faith. Abraham must know God never responds to complaints. Never heard in the Bible ever he responds to complaints. He never responds to self-pity, and very often he doesn't even respond to faith, to needs. But instead, he responds to faith. You know, in the Bible, there was a lady that was having an issue of blood, a flow of blood for 12 years, and she was suffering from one physician to another. There's nothing that they can do. And how many must know what man cannot do, God can do. One day, she got a news. Jesus is in town. I heard a lot of things, good things about Jesus. And something on the inside of her arises. She said, this is my season. And she releases faith and expectation. She said, if only I touch the hem of his garment, I'm going to be healed. And she was healed. And Jesus Christ said, who touched me? And she was afraid. But Jesus put on a smile and said, woman, your faith has made you whole. Now, interesting. You know the story very well. But there are hundreds of people pressing on Jesus. You don't see the astounding testimony of this lady. What distinguishes this lady is this. Here is a lady that reaches out in faith and expectation. And how many must know, faith moves the hand of God. And other people say, the Bible tells us, magnify the Lord with me. God didn't say, magnify the problem. Yeah, the problem may be big. We don't underestimate the challenges that you're facing. But your problem may be big, but your God is almighty. Your problem is no match for the almighty God. And the key thing is to magnify the Lord. Faith is going to be released. And the Bible tells us God enthrones on the praises of his people. In other words, as you praise, as you give thanks, as you release faith in thanksgiving, even in imperfect situation, even in what you don't have, faith is released. And the Bible says he dwells in the praises of his people. He is enthroned in the praises of his people. As you praise, God shows up. Wow, that is what really needed. And other people say, amen. The key thing is give thanks. And your praise move the very hand of God. And giving of thanks releases amazing, amazing, amazing anointing in our life. All right? As I said, I mean, there are hundreds of people pressing on Jesus, but none of them get an amazing encounter and breakthrough. Now, particularly would be the Pharisees. You notice the Pharisees were there, and it's amazing. In the ministry of Jesus, tax collectors, sinners, even prostitutes got healed. And of course, they are being transformed. But very few mention of Pharisees got healed. You know why? Because the Pharisees were so focused on what Jesus was not. But they fall off talking about Jesus, that he eats with tax collectors and sinners, and he's too extravagant, he drinks too much, he eats too much, he's a glutton, and he, above all, heals people on the Sabbath day. And they're so focused on the negative, and they really missed the blessing, the anointing that God has for them. All right? Put it this way, you can be in the right place at the right time with the right people and miss the breakthrough that you wanted to have. I mean, the Pharisees were in the right place, the right time, the right people. But because of their mindset, they missed the blessing. You come into the church, the right church, the right word, the right people, right worship. But you come, focus on negative. Wow, somebody taken away my car park, all right? And the usher never smiled on me. And when you reach your pew, the chairs, someone taken your chair that they've been sitting on for the last 33 years, you get upset, so upset. You're still thinking about the usher, that nasty guy in the car park, that you miss the prophetic word that God has for you. You can be in the right place and the right time with the right people and miss the blessing because of the wrong mindset. Okay? You know, in the Bible, you notice the greatest problem that Jesus has was not demons or demonic possession. Whenever the demons show up, Jesus said, shut up, quietly. Boom, they are quiet. All right? But he got a problem with the Pharisees. And very often we like to, you know, cast blame on things. Oh, Pastor, I don't have problem with smoking. It is a spirit of nicotine. Pastor, I don't have problem with food. Like, it's just a spirit of gluttony. Pastor Prince was sharing that some time ago, people tried to cast out the spirit of chocolate from him. And while we're blaming demons, the demons are so happy. As long as they're blaming me, the demons say, they will not identify the root problem and deal with the problem. Very often, it's the mindset. They focus on the negative, full of resentment, always looking at the wrong thing, and they become unhappy and lost our joy. The key thing is, humble must know, even as we learn from the Feast of the Tabernacle, to give thanks, you're going to be able to see greater, greater measure of breakthrough, and God will show up, and hey, the anointing is going to be released, and going to make us whole, and other people say. Number two, give thanks prophetically, even in your tent. Look at Leviticus 23, verse 43.
So your descendants will know that I had the Israelites live in booths when I brought them out of Egypt. I am the Lord your God.
You know, they're supposed to celebrate in their tents. One of the reasons is to impress upon the kids they have the importance of giving thanks even in imperfect situations. How many of us, when you live a life of thanksgiving, it's going to impact the next generation? If you're always the one that criticize, talk negative, get angry, upset, not only are you going to rob your own destiny, you're going to rob your kids' destiny, but no, you're going to rise up tall today. You're going to say, yeah, I'm going to celebrate at the Feast of the Tabernacle. I'm going to release prophetic anointing upon my children by being thankful. And other people say, amen, hallelujah. And some of us know your words, your life, can make a difference in your life, okay, and your children's life. Because your praise carries creative anointing. See, when you begin to praise God, you release that prophetic and creative anointing. Like what Romans chapter 4, verse 17 tells us, that God called those things that were not as though they were. That's what happened. When God created the world, there was darkness. Did God say, "Ayo, I did all the good thing and all the bad thing happened. I don't want to be God anymore. I resign as God today." Did God say that? No, we look at the darkness. He said, "Let there be light." And boom, there was light. So in other words, look at the imperfect situation. Instead of getting angry, upset, no, you begin to praise. Even if you give thanks, you are prophetically releasing creative anointing upon the situation. Perhaps a medical report came along and say, "Oh, doctors say I got this chronic condition, I'm going to live it the rest of my life." Why don't you just rise up tall, like the people celebrating the Feast of the Tabernacle, and give thanks to God. "Lord, I thank you. Doctors are great, but they don't have the final say. You have the final say. I want to thank you to give us the promise, and I shall live and declare the work of God. And you're going to give the word and heal me." Or perhaps you are facing a very tough assignment, sort of grumbling, murmuring. Why don't you give thanks to God? "Lord, I thank you because I'm in Christ. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." Maybe you're in debt. You realize that the next 40 years, even if you continue to earn the kind of income you're earning right now, you'll never be able to pay up your debts. Why don't you rise up tall and say, "Lord, I thank you that you truly have given me the anointing for increase, and I'm entering into this season of abundance." Give thanks, because as you give thanks, you release faith, all right? They allow God to work in your life. Give thanks for the people round about you. Give thanks for your spouse. Give thanks for your wife. So, Pastor, yeah, I know the Bible promise, huh, that your wife should be a fruitful wine, all right? Intoxicating, giving me joy. But you know, the reality is that she's more of a sour prune. Sin muia. Every day, sour face. Yeah, that may be the fact. But how many must know, even as you give thanks and speak prophetically over your wife, "My wife indeed shall be a fruitful wine." Hey, you are speaking prophetically. And as you are speaking prophetically, you are also speaking creatively. And other people say, amen. Give thanks for your husband. All right. "Oh, Pastor, you know, I wish my husband should be a bit more sensitive. I wish he he can be like a Romeo. Like Chan next door, he's really a Romeo. Yeah, your husband may not be a Romeo, but at least he's a Dumio. So Pastor, what's a Dumio? At least he put food on the table, and all the people say, amen. Pastor, the fact is that, no, he's very dirty, very smelly. What do you expect from a man? See, men were made from dust. You ladies are different. You ladies come from where? The ribs. Proper cell. Now, it doesn't mean that you don't groom your man. I appreciate my children, my wife, grooming me, ask me to wear the right shirt, with the right tie, and the right shoe. They're the one that behind all this, what I'm wearing every Sunday morning. I appreciate them teaching me how to eat, how to dine in a proper way, all right? But, you know, they did it in a very gentle way. They did it in not nagging. The Bible tells us, Proverbs says, I'd rather be sitting on the rooftop of a house eating kwa chi, eating kacang putih or peanut, all right, than spend time with a nagging wife. And then he said, Han, boom, you run down. You jump down. Hey, let me tell you this. Killing is give thanks by being respectful. All right, look at Ephesians chapter 5, verse 33.
Let the wife see that she respects and reverences her husband, that she notices him, regards him, honors him, prefers him, and esteems him.
See? Respects. You know, one of the main causes of marital breakdown is the man don't feel that kind of a respect. All right? Same thing with the woman. They don't feel enough affirmation of praise. Okay? And one of the main causes of marital breakdown is the man don't feel respect. And you have a big problem when he feels respect in somewhere else. All right? This is where all kind of affairs can take place. Again, if you need to respect, it doesn't mean that you don't want to change your man, to try to transform him to be what you think he should be, but you can do it only by grace. Look at Romans chapter 7, verse 5.
For when we were in the flesh, the sinful passions which were aroused by the law were at work in our members to bear fruit to death.
See, the more you focus on what he's done, should be this, should be that, he didn't do this, he didn't do that, the more you nag, the more you complain, the more you murmur. And that is something about human nature. It could arouse on the inside of us, it says here, passions which are aroused by the law and brings fruit to death. The thing is, you know, if your image to your husband is like a headmistress, the husband sitting at the table, you talk like a headmistress, and always, this no good, that no good, do this, do that. After a while, you wonder why your husband don't enjoy spending time with you. It's because you are the picture of the law, okay? The kidding is, give thanks. When your husband see you in Christ, you find, filled with His grace, you find that he's going to be transformed. You mean that we are being transformed as we behold Him, all right? So give thanks for your wife, give thanks for your husband, and give thanks for your children. Oh, Pastor, nowadays are very hard to raise kids, you know. Are you going to send him to this tuition classes, that tuition classes, not to mention all the problems that are coming to me? And hey, one day, when they're gone, you wish to hear, oh, they always make so much noise, I can't even sleep, and all kind of things. Let me tell you, one day, you wish you hear the sound of the little footsteps. Give thanks for the years that are spending with you in your life. And give thanks for your in-laws. One of the ways to make them thankful for them is don't call them in-laws. In RLC, we suggest to you that you call them in-grace. You know why? Because without your father-in-law or mother-in-law, you're not going to have your spouse. And other people say, "Yo, Pastor, you're right, but that is the main problem. Because of my father-in-law, I got my spouse. She talks exactly like him, the same gene. My wife exactly talks like the mother-in-law, exactly the same gene." Hey, you're now a new creation. And other people say, amen. Your new gene is greater than the old gene. Even as you speak prophetically, there's going to be creative power released into the situation. And she's going to be transformed. But if you're complaining, murmuring, resentful, shouting, screaming, you're going to keep her or him as he is. A lot of people say, so give thanks, all right? And when you give thanks, you release creative power. You see that demonstrated by the feeding of the 5,000? Jesus lifted up the 5 loaves and 2 fishes and began to complain. Ay-ya! People getting stingier and stingier. I wanted such a word, more stingy and more stingy, all right? And did he say that? And he would be correct. I mean, out of 5,000 people, even they didn't have five loaves of fish. And it's really very, very miserly of the 5,000 people. But Jesus delivered the five loaves and two fishes, the Bible tells us, he gave thanks. And as he gave thanks, wow, there's astounding multiplication. So in other words, how many of your giving of thanks is powerful? It is prophetic. In other words, calling those things that were not as though they were. Elijah the prophet speak prophetically, I hear the sound of the abundant rain. There was no rain. So your wife, Lord, I thank you. Every morning you get up. She is a fruitful wine. She is intoxicating as the best wine in the world. All right, your husband may not be Romeo, at least he's Dumio. And other people say, amen. Give thanks for who he is. Lastly, give thanks with boldness in Christ's finished work on the cross. Look, Leviticus 23, verse 35.
The first day is a sacred assembly. Do no regular work. For 7 days, present offerings made to the Lord by fire. And on the eighth day, hold a sacred assembly and present an offering made to the Lord by fire. It is the closing assembly. Do no regular work.
I believe this talk about Christ as the burnt offering for our sin. And this is pictured also, remember the battle between the false prophet of Baal and the prophet Elijah. All right, and fire came down. Look at 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 38.
So a fire from the Lord fell down and consumed the burnt offering, wood, stones, and dirt. The fire even dried up the water that was in the trench.
Wow, none of everything is left behind. Even the water is being burned up, right? Supernaturally living behind ashes. Now, take a look at the picture up here. It's a picture of the temple together with the Kidron Valley. All right, if you've been to Israel, you recollect that. All right, one thing is that the priest, during the time of the celebration of the Feast of the Tabernacle, for 7 days, the priest will come down from the temple, look up, all right, see the little pointer there. And from the temple, come from the eastern gate. Now, if you go to the Holy Land, the eastern gate is closed, but those days it's open. And you come on the eastern gate and you walk down the Kidron Valley. This is the Kidron Valley. And the priest holding the pitchers, all right, will go to the vessel, golden vessel from the temple, to go to the Pool of Siloam. Now, remember the Pool of Siloam? During the Feast of the Tabernacle, Jesus healed the man that was born blind, all right? And he said, I'm the light of the world, okay? We look into the Feast of the Tabernacle in the deeper way sometime later. But they pick up the water here, all right? Fill up the golden pitchers vessels with about 3 pints of water. And they will walk back, the priest, while the Kidron Valley, the eastern gate, and inside the temple. Okay, let's look at the temple. All right, the next slide. This is a combination between the tabernacle and the temple because the structure is almost the same, all right? The items are almost the same. And the priest will come into the entrance. Now, in this entrance, if you can see, if not blocking you, there are 15 steps. And in each of the steps, all right, the priest will holding, remember, the pitchers of water, and they will sing one of the psalms in the Bible. And tradition has it that they will sing from Psalm 120 and to Psalm 134. This is the reason why you go to the book of the Psalm. These are called songs of ascents. In other words, going up. So the priest would be singing. Remember holding the pitcher? And they will sing a song of praise. And you notice that in Psalm 120, 134, the songs of ascents, they are overcoming psalms in every areas of challenges or difficulties. All right, almost every area that you're facing, problem, difficulties, the psalm has the answer, giving thanks. So every one of the steps, they give thanks. And by the time they reach to the altar of burnt offering, the altar of burnt offering, one of the first thing that they would see would be the ashes of the burnt sacrifice. Now, the altar of burnt offering is made of bronze. Now, those say bronze has the highest fire resistance because this animal, they're going to be sacrificed, subject to intense heat. And bronze, those say, were the only metal that able to withstand heat, okay? And the bronze altar here is a picture of the cross. When Jesus Christ died for us on the cross, he consumed. He exhausted every ounce of the fire and the judgment of God's wrath against sin. Jesus consumed every ounce of God's wrath against sin. That's the reason why he said, my God, why did you forsake me? At that point in time, Jesus, the Son of God, couldn't call God Father. Because at that time, he bare all your sin and my sin. He consumed the wrath, the fire of God's wrath against him. Until one point, up on the cross, he said, it is finished. And how remember when the high priest in the temple sacrifice, as they sacrifice the burnt offering, when everything is burnt to ashes, the high priest also say, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, it is finished. Exactly at that point in time, 2,000 years ago, Jesus up on the cross cried out, it is finished. Everything is done. Fire came down, consumed the sacrifice. What is left behind in the altar of burnt offering are the ashes. Coming back. All right, remember the priest when he came? Holding the pitchers of water, all they could see are the ashes. Now, what is the ashes a symbol of? The ashes, Hamra must know, are the final product of a sacrifice. In other words, when the sacrifice is done, it's perfectly done, what you see is only the ashes. The first thing that the worshipper, the priest, saw, all right, when they enter into this outer court, are the ashes. Look at the passage in Psalm 65. Why do I say the first thing they saw are the ashes? Because Leviticus chapter 1 tells us the ashes are left behind, according to Leviticus chapter 1, on the eastern side. So they come into the eastern gate, the first thing they see are the ashes. And what are the promises given? Psalm 65 verse 10.
You crown the year with a bountiful harvest. Even the hard pathways overflow with abundance.
Wow, even the dry, hard, arid, rocky, tough, imperfect situation, going to overflow with abundance. Pastor, I don't see the connection. If you look at the Hebrew word abundance, all right, is dashen. Say dashen. Dashen literally means the fatty ashes. Say the fatty ashes of a burnt sacrifice. And in Hebrew, that fatty ashes is translated as abundance. And other people say, so when you greet a Hebrew guy, hey, I wish you abundance, you're saying literally, I wish you have fatty ashes. Because fatty ashes produces abundance. You know what? And the Hebrew priest walk up the stairs, all right, and after all the thanksgiving, remember, the thanksgiving are the channel, the lay hold, the privilege. It's not a work, but it's to receive. And the first thing they saw are the ashes. It just tells us that the key to the blessing, the abundance God has for us is to the ashes. And how do we receive the ashes? The Bible tells in Psalm 20, verse 2, it says, may he send you help from the sanctuary and support you from Zion. In other words, God's way of channeling the blessing, all right, in today's context, would be the sanctuary, the local church, all right, the sanctuary where God's name is being praised, where God's word is being proclaimed, when revelational truth, not theory, not information, not planet warming, not Reader's Digest articles are being presented, but the revelational truth of God's word is being presented, that amazing oil of the fatty ashes is being released. And it says here, support you from Zion. And I believe it is a picture of care groups. If you have not been to a care group, all right, you're fine. You're going to miss a lot of things because that is a general blessing because there's the support and they're going to help. Okay, the next thing is that, remember the beach? The peaches, the vessel, the golden vessel with water, about 4 pints. And they pour into this altar of burnt sacrifice. Now, can you imagine what would have happened? When the water is poured out, it will come down. There's a prophecy in the Bible that water will flow out of the temple and flow east and down and heal the Dead Sea. All right, in the last day, during the millennium rain, the Dead Sea become a sea of fresh water because water will flow from the house of God, from the south of the altar, out east and down, and friend of it. When the water is poured into the altar, can you imagine what would come down from the south of the altar? What would come down when water washes out? What would it washes out? Huh? Ashes are here. What would come out is what? Blood and water. Say blood and water. Now, what happened when the soldiers pierced Christ's body? What come out? And how many of us know that is which would bring healing? And other people say, amen. So this is awesome. But the whole feast of tabernacle talk about Jesus. Now, we have not even entered into here. Okay, can you, would you stay until 2 o'clock? No, of course not. We'll do it some other time, the Lord willing, okay? But I believe that is the key. That is where God gave us beauty for ashes. It's not just the ashes of your broken life, all right? And I believe ashes is the final product of his sacrifice. The ashes, I believe, is the ashes of Christ's complete, finished work on the cross for our sins and bring blessings in abundance, and other people to say. Amen. And the key to that is praise. Not work, but channel whereby the 15th step, the Psalms. All right? So we're going to sing something like we do today, communion. Often communion, we think of slow song. We're going to sing a bit vibrantly today because that's what the priests do. That 150 psalms to choose from. Okay, we believe in all the other choruses and songs, the Hill Song or even Joyce CD. These are good songs, but sometimes without the music, we can't sing. It's nice to listen. Get the CD when you can't listen. The tremendous breakthrough. But nothing like when you are driving and you're able to just sing from memory some of these scripture choruses, because these are the key that they're going to have channels of blessing, enable us to have the right mindset to receive His blessing. And other people say, you ready to sing? It's tremendous power in that blood that washes out south of the altar with blood and water. 2,000 years ago, that same blood flow with water. That is what is going to flow down even in the last day to the Dead Sea, the heal, all right, turn into the fresh water. How many of us know, even as we give thanks and praise Him for what He has done, even in imperfect situation, God could help your life and heal that dryness in your life. We'd like to close, give an opportunity for those of you who have not known Jesus Christ to be Lord of your life, to say this prayer. Would you join together with me to receive Christ into your life? Say together with me, dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus to die for me on the cross. Right now, I receive Him as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, and all of you will scream,
if you have said that prayer and want to know more or have any feedbacks, please write to us.
I will be yours.